Hello, Prof. Joe here. This video is going to be about relative motion using translating and rotating coordinate axis systems. And this is really exciting because this is the culmination of all our kinematic study up to this point. If you remember, we started with just a particle moving on a straight line, the rectilinear motion. Then we said it can curve. We learned curvilinear motion. Then we learned how two particles move when they're dependent on each other, and then later, when they can move in any direction with relative motion. We then moved on to pure rotation with rigid bodies. Then we added translation with rotation for general planar motion. And we learned about relative motion with velocity and acceleration. Even with all of this, we have been leaving one thing out. And let's see if I can explain to you what that one thing is. If you remember the ruler, we had the ruler going through general planar motion, and we said with that ruler that we could make an imaginary ruler that only translated, and then use a local coordinate system on the end of that ruler and say that it rotated about that. So we're doing translation and rotation separately. However, there's a built-in assumption there. The built-in assumption is that these two points, point A and point B, are not changing in relationship to each other. That's what causes it to be pure rotation. If B was sliding towards A or A was sliding towards B, it's no longer pure rotation happening inside our local coordinate axis system. We need to find a mathematical way to take what we know is happening in a local coordinate axis system and translate it into our fixed global coordinate axis system. So that's what we're going to do today. And you can see we have a local coordinate system here, but that local coordinate system is just translating with the ruler. You see it move. So what we want to do is be able to solve problems like this one. This is a cannon, and that cannon has a cannonball in it. And let's say you know the velocity and acceleration that cannonball is leaving the barrel. Okay, so that is linear motion relative to the barrel. However, if, like in this case, the barrel is turning and raising up, it's not linear motion relative to a global coordinate axis system. So we need to find a way to turn that linear motion mathematically and translate it into its global coordinate axis system. So to get a better picture of this, I'm going to use a simpler object. And we're going to use 2D just because it's easier to visualize. All of the equations that we're going to derive today also work in 3D. But we're just going to drive them in 2D because it's easier to visualize. So we have a body here, and there's a little dot on that body. And this body is going to be going through general planar motion as it rotates and translates. And at the same time, that point is going to be moving in a linear fashion on the body. And let's say we know the direction and magnitude of that motion, and we want to be able to translate that to the global fixed coordinate axis system. Well, how we're going to do that is we're going to take our local coordinate axis system and we're going to glue it to the rigid body. We're going to glue it so that not only does it travel with the rigid body, it also rotates. And what that's going to do is it's going to allow us to capture that linear motion in the local coordinate axis system. Now all we need to do is figure out how we mathematically translate that to its motion in the real world, in the Earth fixed coordinate axis system. To do that, we're going to just get a generic vector A, okay? And that generic vector A is in our local coordinate axis system. And we're going to define it in the most general terms as AX, so a little bit in the I direction, plus a little bit in the J direction. And if we were in 3D, a little bit in the K direction. Okay, so we have this general vector. And what we want to figure out is if we take the derivative of that with respect to time, how does the derivative in the local coordinate axis system relate to the derivative in the global? So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to take dA dt, and if I'm taking the derivative, you notice each of these terms actually has two components, ax and I, ay and j. So we have to use the product rule. For the first one, it would be the derivative of ax with respect to time times I plus ax times the derivative of I with respect to time. And the second one would be very similar. We'd have dAy dt plus, oh, times j plus ay times dj dt. Okay, so we have our derivative of this vector a. And it has some terms that look familiar and some that are new to us. So let's go ahead and group those terms. I'm just changing the order of terms is all I'm doing here, and I got a brighter pen, so it's a little easier to see. I'm gonna start off with the dax dt I and dAy dt j. And then I'm gonna add the other two terms. We got ax di dt and ay dj dt. Okay, hopefully these two terms over here look pretty familiar. Those are the terms that we're used to seeing, where the rate of change of the magnitudes of ax and ay in the I and j direction. If we look at our coordinate system, you can see that our global coordinate system, we define unit vectors, I in the x and j in the y. If our local coordinate system is aligned with our global, we can use those same unit vectors in our local coordinate system. And we can use those unit vectors to define a. In this case, it would be 2i plus 1j. Okay, when we have a translating coordinate system, my local coordinate system moved. Did I change at all? No. The coordinate system moved, but I stayed in the same direction, and so did j. And if you notice, even our a vector is still just 2i plus 1j. So if we're just translating, which is what we've been doing up till this point, our local coordinate system, these two would be zero. Di dt and dj dt, the rate of change of those unit vectors with respect to time would be zero because they're not changing direction. But what happens when we add rotation? When we add rotation, obviously our i's and j's are changing with time. So we can't ignore these second two terms, di dt and dj dt. We have to figure out what they are. What we can do is we can take our original I from our global fixed coordinate axis system, and our I prime, which is coming from our rotated coordinate axis system, and this change happened over some time delta t. I just zoomed in on them so we can see them more clearly, and we have an omega. Now, this is where I need to introduce a little bit of Greek. This omega looks different than an omegas that you've been using. Lowercase omega looks kind of like this curvy W. Capital omega looks like this. That's just lowercase and capital, the same Greek letter. We're going to use capital omega for a very special purpose. It's still angular velocity, but it's going to be the angular velocity of our coordinate system. If it's an angular velocity of a local coordinate system, we're going to use capital. If it's angular velocity of anything else, we're going to still use the omega we've used before. That is just a choice in notation to distinguish the two. Okay, it's no different than another omega, but I do know it looks different. Okay, so we have an omega, and these are rotating over some time delta t. You can see we have our I and our new I prime, and then we have our j and our new j prime. What we want to do is figure out, well, what is this change in I and change in j? Okay, and this is very similar to some other derivations that we've done. And hopefully you're thinking at this point we can use our arc length trick. Now, what is the arc length trick? Well, if you have a radius that is swept through a given theta, the length of an arc, which in this case would be this arc, is going to be the angle in radians multiplied by the radius. Well, in this case, these are unit vectors, so the radius is 1. So whatever our change in theta is going to be equal in magnitude to our change in I. So we could say that our change in theta is going to be equal in magnitude to our change in I. Now, I don't have a hat over this. These are scalar equations. We need to look at the drawing to get direction. If I wanted to add this as a vector, our change in I as a vector is going to be equal to d theta as a magnitude, but what direction is it in? Looking at the drawing, it doesn't look exactly perpendicular to I, but if you imagine what we're going to do, the magic of calculus, is we're going to take smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller time periods until the I prime is just barely different from the I. At that case, hopefully you can see that it is approaching being parallel. So really, the change in I would be equal to the change in theta in magnitude, but it would be in the j direction. If we look at the same thing on top here, we'd have a change in theta. And you can see that one would be in the negative I direction. So our delta, our change in j, would be equal to delta theta in the negative I. Okay. Now these are approximations, but of course, if we divide both of these by delta t, that amount of time that we're rotating, and then we get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller delta t's, at some point they approximate exact, and we would have dj dt is equal to d theta negative d theta dt times I. Okay, we'd also have di dt, which I'll put over here, is equal to d theta dt times j. It's a negative for the I, and j, there's no negative. So as you can see, we're getting a vector j that is perpendicular to that unit vector I. It's also perpendicular to our omega. And it has the magnitude of our omega, which is our d theta dt. So what operation will give us a vector that's perpendicular to two other vectors? Hopefully you're thinking of the cross product. This right here, di dt, is actually di dt is just going to be equal to capital omega, how that coordinate axis system is changing, crossed with I. Okay, if you cross capital omega as a vector with I, you're going to end up getting the magnitude of omega, which I'm going to call d theta dt to match below, that magnitude, and you're going to get a vector perpendicular to both of them, which is going to be our j. Similarly, dj dt is going to be equal to that capital omega crossed with j, which is would be equal to d theta dt I, but there'd be a negative on it, because every time you cross something with j, you end up adding that negative. And omega is in the k direction. K cross j gives us a negative I. So our di dt is omega cross I. Our dj dt is omega cross j. But now we need to get these two terms in there. Well, I can add the ax here. I can add the ay here. And you see that we end up getting ax times our di dt and our ay times our dj dt. So if we're crossing omega with ayi or axi and ayj, we can combine those two. And we can say this whole term here is just equal to omega crossed with the original vector, A. Okay, I'm just going to clear up a little bit of space and we'll put this all together. So what we learned is that our derivative of A with respect to time, now this is based off our global fix. This is our absolute rate of change of that vector. It's going to be equal to the rate of change in the local coordinate system. This is our how A is changing relative to I and J in our local coordinate system. We're going to call that the velocity, or dA, if it was position, it'd be velocity. We're just going to call it dA dt. But what's happening in the local x, y, z? This is new notation to us. This is just going to mean the derivative of A with respect to time in our local x, y, z. What's happening relative to those local axes? But then we've got to add on to it how the axes are changing and how that's affecting the global. And that we learned was omega, this capital omega, which is how our axis is rotating, crossed with the original vector. This is a very useful equation, an equation that we can use for any vector in a system where we have a global fixed and a local coordinate axis system. And let's see how that changes our relative motion equations and adds a term. I'm going to clean this board up and we'll dive into that. Okay, we have our newly derived equation up here that's telling us how the rate of change of any vector globally is related to the rate of change in that local coordinate system plus how that coordinate system is rotating crossed with the original vector. Now what we're going to do is go back to our original relative motion equation, which was the position of one point is equal to the position of another point plus the relative position of B with respect to A, and make sure that our pseudo canceling works. I wrote a little bit too high there. Okay, here we have our newly derived equation relating the rate of change of any vector with respect to time to its rate of change in its local coordinate system plus how that coordinate system is rotating crossed with the original vector. Now what we're going to do is go back to our original relative motion equation, which was the position of one point is equal to the position of another point crossed with, or plus, the relative position of B with respect to A. And we check our pseudo-canceling and make sure that's written properly. We have our relative motion equation. Now we're going to take the derivative of that again. You notice that the first two terms are already referencing the global coordinate axis system. The third term is B with respect to A. This is the term that would be changing inside our local coordinate axis system. We're going to have to use our newly derived equation for that term. The first two, when we take the derivative, just going to be the velocity of B equals the velocity of A. And now we're going to have to use our newly derived term. We're going to have to add on to that the derivative of R, the B with respect to A, with respect to time in our local x, y, z, plus however our axis is changing crossed with the original vector. Okay, I'm just going to rearrange terms here and rename this rate of change of position as a velocity. The velocity of B equals the velocity of A. I'm going to put this omega term first. And then rename this as velocity of B with respect to A within our local x, y, z. Okay, if you look at this first part, this is the relative motion equation we've been using up till this point. The only difference is we have a capital omega versus a lowercase omega. Now keep in mind this is still an omega, it's an angular velocity. It just happens to be the one that is affecting our local coordinate axis system. And over here we have a new term, and this term has been zero up till now, because if you remember when we're doing the ruler, these two points are not moving in relationship to each other, so the relative velocity of A with respect to, or B with respect to A, would have been zero within our local coordinate system. So now what we want to do is move on to acceleration. I'm going to put our newly derived velocity equation on top and we'll derive acceleration. Okay, here we have our newly derived equation for velocity with this new term of our relative velocity in the local xyz, and we have our equation for any vector inside a rotating coordinate axis system. So what we need to do is take another derivative. And we're going to get, when we get that, the first two are already relative to our global. So we'll get the acceleration of v. We'll get the acceleration of b is going to be equal to the acceleration of a. Those two terms are pretty simple and self-explanatory, just taking derivative of velocity of b and velocity of a. The next section, we need to use the product rule on that omega cross r, the position of b with respect to a. So let's do that. We'll take the derivative of omega cross position of b with respect to a. This is going to be quite a few terms with respect to time. First, we use the product rule. We'd have our d capital omega dt crossed with the position of b with respect to a. Okay, this first term, d omega dt, we typically call that alpha. The reason we're keeping it as d capital omega dt is to just remember that that's capital omega. Okay, we don't have a capital alpha to use, so we're going to keep it as d capital omega dt. And that just means the rate of change of the angular velocity of our coordinate system, or the angular acceleration of that coordinate system. And we're crossing that with position. Now we got to use the product rule, and we got to add on to that omega crossed with, and now we have to take the derivative of the position of b with respect to a dt. Well, if you remember, we did that in the just one slide ago where we use this equation up here. So the position, the derivative of the relative position of b with respect to a is going to be equal to the derivative of the position of b with respect to a dt in our local xyz. We need our other two terms here. I'm going to add on to that omega crossed with the original vector, which would be the position of b with respect to a. And all of that is this one term, so we have to cross omega with it. Okay, so we've got to add all those on. I'm going to go ahead and do it up here. We've got d capital omega dt crossed with the position of b with respect to a. Okay, I got this part. Now I'm going to add on to it omega, and I'm going to put this one first just to stay in the same order. Omega cross omega cross position of b with respect to a, and that gets rid of this term. Okay, now I need this term here. I'm going to add on to it omega crossed with the velocity of b with respect to a in the local xyz. I'm getting that from right here. This omega crossed with this. Okay, we have all the terms for that second part of it. Okay, so we have our newly derived velocity equation with that extra term and our capital omega. And we have our equation over here for any vector that is changing in a rotating coordinate axis system. We're going to combine those two and take another derivative. So here we're going to say the first two terms are pretty self-explanatory. We just have the acceleration of b is equal to the acceleration of a. Those two are already they're already relative to the fixed coordinate system. The next term, let's expand that a little. We're going to take the derivative of our capital omega crossed with the position of b with respect to a dt. Okay, this is a cross product, so we need the product rule. We'd have d omega dt crossed with the position of b with respect to a, plus omega crossed with the derivative of the position of B with respect to A. Now that is within our local coordinate system, so we have to use our equation up here. So omega is going to be crossed by all of that, and the first term is just going to be that derivative of the position of B with respect to A in our local xyz. Okay, and then we have to add onto that capital omega crossed with the original vector, which would be position of B with respect to A. Okay, now we can add all of that into our equation up top here. So we got the acceleration of A, and then I'm going to add these terms, d omega dt crossed with the position of B with respect to A. And I've got this first term. I'm going to add on to that. I'm going to do this one first, just to stay in the same order as we had before. And do I omega crossed with omega crossed with the position of B with respect to A. And I have this term taken care of. And then I can add on our final term here. And this, the derivative of position with respect to time, is going to be our relative velocity of B with respect to A in the local xyz. Okay, we have all of those terms for just this second part. I'm going to free up a little space, and we'll talk about the third part. Okay, for the final term in our velocity equation, we're going to take the derivative of the velocity of A in the local xyz. And really that should be A with B with respect to A. It looks like I messed up there. And it's fixed. So the velocity of B with respect to A in the local xyz, we're taking the time derivative of that. And we have to use our equation up here because that is one of the vectors in our local coordinate system. So that's going to be equal to the derivative of velocity with respect to time in our local, which is just going to be the acceleration in our local. So the first term will be the acceleration of B with respect to A in our local x, y, z. And that's taking care of this first term right here. And we have to add on to that capital omega crossed with the original vector, the velocity of B with respect to A, x, y, z. Hold on a minute, that looks pretty familiar. This term right here is exactly the same thing as that term. And that's how we get two of those. I can just add a two in front of my omega. And we have two of those terms now. And then we have to add on to the end of it our acceleration of B with respect to A in the local x, y, z. And we have our full acceleration equation for a translating and rotating coordinate axis system. You'll notice there are quite a few new terms. And in all the problems we've done so far, all of those terms ended up being zero because this was our original equation, this part. And it's still just like it was before. The only difference is omega is capital. But you notice all the other terms have these change this velocity of B with respect to A in the local xyz, or acceleration B with respect to A in the local xyz. That's how two points are moving in relationship to each other. When we had our ruler or any of the other problems where our two points are not moving in relationship to each other, those two terms were zero, and we're right back to the same equation that we've been using up till this point. That's what's so great about this equation. We've taken all the training wheels off. We now have the full equation, and it applies to all relative motion problems. However, in many relative motion problems, some of the terms will be zero. So there you go, our acceleration equation derived from using our rule for a generic vector in a rotating translating coordinate axis system. Please check out the sample problem to see how we use these in problems, and let me know if you have any questions.